Do you want to learn how to use a multimeter but feel like it's a big, complicated step that you have to have an electrical engineering degree to understand? Luckily, you've come across the right video, so you don't have to worry about all that. In this video, you are going to learn how to use a multimeter on a car. We will be using a multimeter with manual settings, which does mean there's a few more selections available on this dial, but the alternative is having to buy a more expensive tool with automatic settings and potentially not learning some of the simple but vital information about the tool you're using. Plus, there are mistakes that you can make that may damage even the more automatic tools, so it's good all around to start with a less expensive multimeter. However, since we are living in a time where hybrid and electric cars are widely available, I must clarify that this is for cars with just the basic 12-volt system. If you see a bundle of orange or other dangerous-looking wires, put the probes down and leave it to the professionals. Most hybrid and electric vehicles do have the ability to deliver a fatal shock and will require special equipment and understanding. This video will be explaining how to deal with voltage levels that, unless you have an electronic device on you keeping you alive, are quite safe to work with. First, what is a multimeter? As the name suggests, it can meter multiple things. But what are those things? Well, a multimeter tends to have these four basic features we will cover and may include other features that we won't be getting into today or won't be useful on most automotive applications. If you just bought a multimeter and are following along, make sure you install the battery first if it isn't already in there. To turn the multimeter on, you will either have a power button to press, or it will turn on just by not having the dial in the off position. Before you use your multimeter, inspect your probes, which are also called leads. Make sure there's no damage on their wires. In the best case scenario, wire damage will give you a bad reading, but they can also cause electricity to flow where you don't want it to, which can cause damage to electrical systems, start fires, or hurt someone. Don't try to repair these wires, just buy a new set of leads. Once you know all the leads are in good condition, plug your black probe into the common plug here, since that's the same for everything you'll do with your multimeter. To hold these probes properly, stay back from the conductive metal tip. There's usually some sort of suggested area to keep your fingers behind, such as this wall here. When you're working with 12 volts, this safety zone tends to be way further than you need, but it's a good habit to get into in case you later get confident and work with higher voltages. Most commonly used is the voltmeter, which will measure the difference in voltage between two points. For example, this car battery. But wait, you can't just touch two probes to the battery post and hope for the best. On this meter, there's a dial, and you will have to use it to tell the meter what you want to measure. We will be using V for volts, but which V is the right one? In nearly every part of the car, you will be dealing with direct current, as opposed to alternating current. Direct current has this line with dashes, while an alternating current looks like a wave both in charts and on this multimeter symbol. So we are selecting V with the line and dashes, but what about the numbers? Those are the maximum voltages that that setting is designed to work with. Since 12 volt systems tend to stay below 16 volts with the alternator at peak voltage, this 20 selection will work well for us today. You could use the 200 volt setting, but you will get a less precise measurement with no trade-off upside. If you selected a voltage that is too low, you will get some sort of indication that the measurement is out of range, like this. What about our probes though? We already have the black probe plugged into the common connection, so this red probe will plug into the multi-use port. Now that we have the meter set up, let's try a real-life application. This battery can be measured with or without a connected circuit, that is, on or off the car. The red probe to the positive post, and the black probe to the negative post, and you should get a voltage reading. Whew. Also, wear your safety gear when working with a battery. If you were to put the red probe on the negative and the black probe on the positive, you end up with a negative reading. This is okay for the multimeter. Now let's take a look at amperage. To do this, we'll need to do a few things. First, we need to assess how many amps we think there will be on a circuit. While sometimes that involves some math, a quick and easy way to assess that on a car is by simply looking in the fuse box. Most multimeters have a 10 amp limit, but make sure by reading the manual that came with yours. Since both of my multimeters come with a 10 amp limit, anything with a fuse higher than 10 amps is going to be outside of what you can measure with one of these. Your multimeter has a quick blow fuse in it to protect the tool from damage, and while those fuses aren't crazy expensive, you don't want to use them as a way of measuring that something is more than 10 amps. Okay, so you're going to test a circuit that you estimate has 6 amps based on either calculation or the 7.5 amp fuse that it has. We need to select the 10 amp DC setting on the selector here and make sure that you don't accidentally select milliamps if your meter has it. You will also need to move the red probe over to the 10 amp fused plug here. Let's measure that circuit. Unlike the simple touch that voltage testing needed, with amperage we need to make the multimeter part of the circuit by breaking into the circuit somewhere and using the leads to complete the circuit again. The circuit also needs to be powered in whatever way you are testing. For example, if you need to know how many amps a light bulb uses and there are different brightness settings available, then you will need to put the light on the brightest setting to make sure the highest amperage is seen. Okay, now on to resistance, or ohms. Resistance makes it hard for electrical power to get through and alters the amperage of the circuit. As resistance gets higher, amperage gets lower. With resistance, you'll probably need to adjust and find out as you go in order to get a more exact reading. On the dial, start by looking for the Greek letter omega, which looks like a tree in front of a fence or a horseshoe with some extra flare at the end. Select whichever resistance you think will be closest to what you are testing. You won't have to worry about the fuse on this setting, so feel free to play around with it. Finally, move your probe lead to the multifunction plug again. When you test a component for resistance, make sure it is isolated from electrical interference, which throws off the reading. This resistor unit here has nothing connected to it, nothing powering it, so we will be able to get a good reading by putting the probe on each end. You can even test for total resistance by putting the resistors in series in a row like this, or in parallel, side by side like this, and you will see different resistance values for the total arrangement. Just like with the voltage setting, you need to find the right setting and you may see an out of range indication if it's on the wrong setting. Very similar to the resistance setting is the continuity setting, which is used to confirm that there is a continuous conductive path between one probe and the other. Select the continuity setting on your multimeter dial, which will often have a diode symbol, but not always. It also typically has the symbol for sound, because when continuity is detected, it will emit a tone. To make sure that it is working properly, touch the two leads together. Now that we know the continuity test works, now we'll test for continuity on a wire. Sounds good. Now let's test the continuity of a few other items. This diode will be a good example of the limitations. In one direction, electricity is able to flow through the diode, so we get a continuity sound. However, in the other direction, we hear nothing, which makes sense, that's what a diode is supposed to do. With this model, you don't get any sound, you just get a reading on the screen. There will be a certain amount of resistance that will prevent the multimeter from making that tone, and it will differ from model to model. Let's run a few more examples before the next video to make sure you got everything. To determine the voltage difference between two points on a direct current circuit, select the DC voltage option that is the next one above what you expect to measure. Make sure the red lead is plugged into the multifunction port. Touch the metal tips of the two probes to the two points that you want to test, and you will get a reading. To test a component, make sure the component has no power flowing through it, and the lead still needs to be in the multifunction port. Connect to the two ends of the component in ohms mode to get a resistance, adjusting the range on the dial to get a more precise measurement. This same setup works for continuity too, but remember that that has limitations. Finally, the most risky setting for your tool, amperage. Plug your red lead into the appropriate port. There will be more than one port for amperage testing sometimes. Here I'm using my 10 amp limited range, so I've selected that with the dial and plugged into the 10 amp plug. With this, we have to make the multimeter itself part of the circuit, and as long as the amperage isn't too high, the fuse doesn't blow, and we get a reading. Most of what you saw today was on the bench here, but you can see the multimeter being put into real-world use in this video, or you can learn more about automotive electronics in this video. Thanks for watching.